There isn't any question that if we did not secure adequate special arrangements for continued access for our products, butter, cheese, lamb again, into this market or into the expanded common market if Britain goes in, we just would have no other markets in the world for this produce. And so it would be economic disaster. Well, the social disaster would follow closely on the heels of economic disaster.
You mean in terms of farms being put out of business?
Oh, I mean that, but the whole of the community. You see, our farming industry is the basis of our whole society, of our whole economy and our whole society. And if we lost this kind of a market or any substantial portion of it with nowhere else in the world to turn, I say again, it would be disastrous economically and inevitably socially.
The Ridley family have been living in Holland for the last 3 months. Mr. Ridley is working there. And they have had a first-hand experience of what living in the common market is like. Yet at the same time, they still remember life in Britain. How have Mrs. Ridley and her friend, who also lives in Holland, found the prices of goods in the shops?
Some of them are practically double the price. Butter being, I think, the main one that you first notice, you know.
In England, I use butter all the time. I only buy margarine for cooking. But here, I have to use margarine all the time. Because it's so dear to buy, I wouldn't buy it.
Well, I try not to think about how much I spend each week.
Mine's
more than what I spend in England, definitely, without a question.
Mine's more than double.
You go into a supermarket and you'll see lots of different kinds of margarine and just one kind of butter sort of tucked away somewhere. That's probably, you know, explained by the price of it.
Oh, yeah, that's butter, yeah.
I think it's about 8 and 6 pence a pound. Twice the price of English butter.
You know, they don't have a lot of it.
Yeah, never have known that was butter.
Yeah. What, your milk?
I want some cheese. I think cheese is very expensive.
Yeah, I think in Holland you would have thought that
it would be cheaper.
It's not the case at all, is it?
I only buy the spread cheese now since I've came here.
You're more kind of like
bread. Well, we don't
I used to buy the loose cheese when I was in England. Pieces of cheddar and Cheshire, but I don't hear.
Because bacon is ludicrous.
Oh, it's terrible.
Well, I worked it out once and I gave up after that. 11 and sixpence a pound.
Children's shoes are very dear. Expensive, and so are socks. For a pair of socks for the children, about 7 and 6 a pair. At home, you can get a pair for 3 shillings,
oh,
3 and 6,
yeah.
And they double the prices here.
And Holland is the cheapest of all the common market countries.
In this field, were all apple trees, and now they all are bulldozed, because it was not longer profitable to haul them.
Why wasn't it profitable?
It was not longer profitable because there come so very much French apples since the common market started.
How will British fruit farmers get on if Britain joins the common market?
When the play isn't fair and French farmers, fruit farmers, get their subsidies and should go the same thing with the English fruit farmers. If it's us, then you see it here.
Many British fruit growers are understandably extremely worried at the prospect of joining the common market and the effect it will have on their livelihood. Mr. Norbury, who farms 550 acres of fruit near Malvern in Worcestershire, a farm which his father before him built up from 4 acres, expresses their viewpoint.
I have many grower friends in Holland and Germany, and since they've been in the common market, they have been completely ruined. The compensation has been quite inadequate, and they have not been able to compete against subsidized competition from France. And I feel that horticulture is being used as one of the giveaway things in order to get us into the common market. Well, nobody wants to be a giveaway thing or a loss leader. But I've just come back from Italy, And you may think with this enormous surplus of fruit, it's cheaper in the shops. In fact, it's more expensive than here. And also, if we go into the common market, you won't see any Commonwealth fruit here from New Zealand, Australia, and South Africa. You never saw any of that in Italy or France, because there's a high tariff against that stuff. So at this time of year, in May, we shall be eating stale French Golden Delicious. That'll be the offering to the public.
Nor are fruit growers the only community who feel threatened by the common market. Three quarters of the area of Scotland is devoted to hill farming. Many hill farmers in Scotland and elsewhere are worried lest the common market agricultural policy would sooner or later force them off the hills. Hill farming might become uneconomic unless, in the course of our negotiations, firm assurances are obtained from the common market. The inshore fishermen are another large group of people who will suffer unless proper and firm assurances are agreed before we join. British policy is to conserve the stocks of fish around our shores, regulating the size of our nets so that they do not catch the small young fish. In addition, we have largely stopped foreign fishermen coming into our waters by imposing a 12-mile limit round our shores. The common market countries have a smaller mesh, and they also fish right up to the beaches, which we don't allow. In this way, far from conserving their stocks, they have fished out their own shores. Our fishermen are worried by this policy. One of the curious things about this fishing question is that just before we started serious negotiations to join the common market, the six countries of the common market decided on their fishing policy, which they knew would be totally unacceptable to us. Why did they do it? Because they have fished out their own shores and they want the fish from this country. So before we vote on it in Parliament, the government must make absolutely tight arrangements so that the fishermen are protected. Now, can you tell me, what is the difference between our system of conservation and regulation and the system of the common market?
Well, the British government has always had a policy of conservation.
But both parties, you mean?
Both parties, both socialist and conservative, have always pursued this policy. And British fishermen as a whole have abided by this policy. Now they propose to turf this right over the side and go in for the continental method, right up to the beaches, a free-for-all. It's just not good for the fishing.
And you yourselves, even now, can't come right up to the beaches, can you?
No, we can only come within 3 miles.
And that then conserves the stocks?
That's right. Itself. It gives the breeding grounds a chance.
Yes. Now, what about the housewife and the fish that she likes to have now and the fish that she gets from you so very well and fresh and so on? What would the effect be if we went into the common market upon that problem?
She'd have a change of type of fish altogether. I don't think she'd take very kindly to it, because she's been used by fresh fish in this country, and after all, it'll have to be fish from Iceland and Greenland. Once they clear the stocks here, it's Iceland, Greenland, and these places the fish will have to come
fish
from.
Fingers. Yeah.
Fish fingers.
And that will be not fresh fish, but perhaps frozen fish.
Frozen fish, yes.
I see. So the British housewife won't like this at all.
I don't think so. No,
I see. The problem is about the lives of people. Not only these fishermen, but the whole industry which backs them up. The boat builders, the packers, the curers, the distributors, and their families, whole communities with little alternative employment. So the key is to keep British control within the 12-mile limits.
For motor vehicles going into New Zealand, the British manufacturer has a preference over all others of approximately 40%. Now, I could quote others, but that's an outstanding one, and shows that British goods and services have a very special preference and a very special position in New Zealand's market. So, you would stand to lose two things. First of all, we believe first-grade primary produce, butter, cheese, and lamb, at low prices, the most economically produced in the world, you would lose that. And on the other hand, you would obviously lose, because you'd have a common market tariff, not a special British preferential tariff, you would lose your special position in New Zealand market.
As far as industry is concerned, the effect, broadly speaking, I think will be neutral. It's a matter of swings and roundabouts. Some industries will gain, some sectors will gain. Others will lose or suffer from tougher competition and have to contract. There's no reason to expect a tremendous transformation of our overall industrial performance. And in this connection, I'd particularly like to stress the fact that the added spur to greater efficiency from a reduction of tariffs and from an enlargement of the so-called home market, if we join the E.E.C., is really quite trivial. On agriculture, there will quite clearly be a significant, not an enormous, but a significant drop in our living standards, because we shall have to pay more for food, or else eat cheaper and nastier food.
Such as what?
Such as more bread and margarine and less eggs, cream, butter and cheese.
That surely means a lower standard.
Precisely.
Isn't it?
A lower standard.
Certainly for the poorer section of our community.
No doubt about that at all.
If we do go in, it's going to cost us a lot of money. Now, the pro-marketeers say that if we can get our growth rate up by 0.5%, that this should cover the cost of going in. Do you think our growth rate will automatically increase?
Absolutely not. When a relatively slow-growing country joins a club of relatively fast-growing ones, there is absolutely no reason to expect the growth effects to transmit themselves and to transform the growth rate of the slow grower. You might as well argue that if we join the common market, our weather will become like that in the south of France. The drop in our living standards, the cost to this country from joining the common agricultural policy, is clear and undoubted and universally agreed. The benefits from faster growth are entirely in the minds of the pro-market propagandists. There is no solid reason to expect much change either way on the industrial front, and therefore there is no reason to expect the cost through higher food prices to be offset by gains in other sectors.
So if we join, what will be the size of the payments we shall have to make for agriculture to the common market?
Well, very roughly, it'll be somewhere between, one can say this with a fair degree of certainty, somewhere between 1% and 2% of our national income in Britain each year.
How much
now,
is that,
the equivalent of that is very roughly, it's like developing a Concorde airliner by ourselves each year.
What, completely?
A complete Concorde airliner by ourselves each year.
Really, as much as that?
Yeah.
So what will we do if we don't go in?
Well, it may well be that we shall continue to grow more slowly, our output will continue to grow more slowly than that of the continental countries, as it has done. But on the other hand, we can raise our living standards, we can manage our affairs as we have been in the past, only, I hope, you know, with perhaps greater efficiency and more success, by pursuing the course that we have pursued in the past, working for an enlargement of our trading relations with all parts of the world, not joining any particular club, but trading with all of them. After all, we already do more than 20% of our trade now with the six common market countries without being a member.
So what you are really saying is that we have to extend our free trade as much as possible, as often as we can.
Absolutely.
That's the best thing for this country.
I think so.
But at the heart of the common market debate is the political question. At the headquarters of the European Economic Commission in Brussels, they say openly that economic and political unity are two sides of the same coin. The Commission, which employs over 5,000 civil servants, can, after discussion, of course, issue directives affecting the lives of people in the common market which have to be obeyed. They want a properly elected parliament to control them, a parliament which debates matters and comes to conclusions by a vote. Ultimately, this parliament will have budgetary powers. It will decide taxation, agricultural policy, and other matters, such as foreign affairs and defence, leaving only the most trivial matters to be decided in the national parliaments.
Now, when there is a European parliament, and you have the European civil service now, there must logically be, between the two, a European government with European ministers. Chancellor Brandt of Germany confirmed that this was the logical development of the common market in the end. If Europe is to speak with one voice, surely it must can only speak through one parliament and one government. Now, you may feel today in Britain that government is perhaps a little remote from you, but if we should join the common market, it will be remoter still. What are the implications of this for Britain? Enoch, there are very many varying views in politics, but on this question of sovereignty, I think you and I are agreed that there will be a loss of sovereignty.
Well, of course there'll be a loss of sovereignty. That's what it's all about. If you talk about political unity, it must mean a merging of sovereignty, and therefore a loss of sovereignty by the parliaments and the nations which merge. And it's interesting that as time has gone on, this has been emphasized more and more by those who are in favor of joining. That casts an interesting light, I would have thought, on the economic arguments, but let that pass. So, of course, it means it is about pooling, that is, loss of sovereignty. And this isn't something remote. There is the argument, oh, well, that may happen a long time in the future. No, of course not. It happens at once. What do people think the argument is about Britain's contribution to the agricultural policy of the community? At the moment, the British Parliament decides British agricultural policy. The instant we're in the common market, British agricultural policy, which is of some little importance, we have a few debates on the subject, is not going to be decided by the Parliament at Westminster. Of course it isn't. It's going to be decided somewhere else. Now, I know they say, oh yes, but if it's an important matter, then we can stand out. If it's an important matter, we can insist on unanimity, which means a veto. Can we? Are we seriously going into something which is described as political unity on the ground that we're going to veto anything with which we disagree? Joining this means from the beginning that Parliament in this country ceases to decide some of the most important questions. And if it means anything, then as time goes on very rapidly, more and more of the most important questions are not going to be decided by the British Parliament, are not going to be decided by the British people. Incidentally, I hope they're going to be allowed to decide whether we go in or not, but let that pass. They're going to be decided somewhere else. We have a voice, they say. Well, yes, the smallest minority has a voice, but it's a voice which is listened to and then voted down. That's what it means. That's what it's about. Of course, it means surrender of sovereignty.
Like Mr. Powell, Mr. Peter Shaw has been a cabinet minister. He was Minister of Economic Affairs in the last government. Peter, if we join the common market, how much power do you think we shall lose over our own economic affairs in this country?
An enormous amount. I think, of course, in the first place, we've got to accept the fact that the terms of entry themselves are going to require from us an entrance fee, a continuing annual subscription of a size which I don't think the people of this country as yet have any notion of. And as a consequence of that, an enormous weakening of our overall economic position. I mean, I've never myself seen a figure which suggested that we should pay less than £400 million a year simply in order to become a member of the Club of the Six. But that apart, there are two things. First, we have to make an immense down payment of the power of economic decision making which we have enjoyed in this country so far. We have to, for example, accept that in the future we should not be able to make commercial treaties. There would not be a Britain commercially. It wouldn't exist that nations that wanted to sign trade treaties with us, for example, would not be able to do so. They would have to make their treaties with the Six, because Britain would not be there. We would lose gradually the distinguishing power of British democracy, of people deciding for themselves how the money, the taxes which they provide should be spent, and how and in what form the taxes should be raised. Something which we have fought for in this country since the days of Oliver Cromwell, and something for which people of British stock had a Boston Tea Party to fight for in a more recent date. But this is the down payment, and there's more to come. Now, all I can say to this is that there is no parallel in our history to what is proposed, what is intended, what will take place. And we, at the end of the day, if we were to pursue this course, would find ourselves with an emasculated half state. It would no longer be a British government controlled by the British people.